The beauty of cut foliage and ferns, next on Gardener's Hotline. This is Gardener's Hotline, and I'm your host, Karen Stotterman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension agent. Florida's cut foliage industry started near the turn of the 20th century when growers of asparagus fern started shipping iced fern sprays by train to florists in the Northeast. In the 1950s, leatherleaf fern was introduced. It was ideal in durability, beauty, and low cost. It remains popular today. Did you know that Florida produces 81% of all the cut foliage in the United States? Meet David Register. He is the president of Fern Trust, located in Pearson, Florida, and a commercial grower of cut foliage. Welcome to the show, David.
I'm excited to be here, Karen.
David, I want to hear all about what happens at the fernery. Let's start by what happens in a regular day.
Well, first thing in the morning, most of our harvesters wake up about daylight. We like to get in the field early because, as you know, it gets very hot in Florida. So first thing in the morning, they arrive at the fernery and go into the beds of fern, the leatherleaf fern, like you can see on the screen there. They harvest every single spray by hand, grade it for color and quality, and then wrap them with rubber bands.
How many are in a bundle?
Typical bundles of leatherleaf are 20 sprays. Some of the other varieties, we only put 10 sprays in. A lot of it has to do with the type of variety of foliage that we're harvesting.
How many acres do you have there? What kind of cut foliage do you have?
We have about 350 different acres. Fern Trust is comprised of 13 different growers. And I think we grow about 36 different varieties of foliage.
Wow, how many people work there?
We have between 85 to 120, kind of depends on the season. You know, at Valentine's and Mother's Day, when it's a lot busier and everybody's giving flowers, we employ a little more people than we do during the rest of the year.
What kind of varieties do you have out there?
Some of the varieties we have are the asparagus varieties. We have plumosa, tree fern, leatherleaf, nagai, different types of liriope, feather fern. There's just a myriad of different types of foliages available.
Sounds like you keep busy pretty much most of the year.
Pretty much year round. I mean, people are given flowers, thankfully, 12 months out of the year. It's not just a one season holiday.
Well, once you collect the ferns, then what do you do from there out in the field? Does it go to a packing house?
Yeah, it's stacked on these baskets. You might see them moving around different parts of Florida. They're winched up and then put into a cold water bath. The cold water bath is there to get the field heat out of them. You know, it's 100 degrees plus sometimes out in the fields in Florida. So the most important thing you need to do to make ferns last a long time is get that heat out of them and basically put them into suspended animation or asleep by getting them cold and keeping them cold throughout the chain.
Now, do these also get traveled sent locally or internationally? Where are your markets at?
Our markets are worldwide. I mean, they're here right in Volusia County. You know, there's different florist shops that use them. We sell wholesale all across the United States, almost in every state in the Union, Canada, Western Europe. We sell to a lot of the big importers there who export it to other countries in Europe. Then we also sell to the Middle East, Japan, those types of countries. So
fresh
it goes everywhere.
From Florida.
Yeah.
Well, David, I know we have a lot of viewers at home that have some questions they want to ask you. And now is your time to ask those questions. And you can join in the program by calling in with this number. Are you ready? It's 1-800-901-9238. Well, I know the first question I want to ask is, you have so many different colors here. Tell me a little bit about the colorants that you use for your foliage.
Well, the colorants that we use, you can see some of them painted here. It's actually a latex-based paint, almost the same as what you'd paint your house with. We mix them in-house so we can custom do colors. So, you know, different people have different weddings and they want a special color for their wedding. We can custom mix those. They're painted with a special patented process we have. And from there, it It can, you know, be any one of maybe 15 or 20 different colors depending on the seasons. We do a lot of fall colors now. Christmas time, we do Christmas colors and metallic silvers and gold. In the springtime, when it's spring, we do a lot of pinks and pastel colors. So,
now, do you have the secretaries in the office working there helping you out too?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the whole mission of Fern Trust is to make sure that we can provide any type of foliage that anybody would need anywhere in the world. And we cannot reach out to the world without the ladies in the office doing the sales. They're our link to the outside world. I mean, they're the people that get it done for us every day.
And of course, what lady wouldn't like to have flowers? Now, David, be honest. What is the strangest color you've ever had to paint with foliage?
You know, one of the strangest colors that I thought was going to be really ugly at first, but turned out to be one of our number one sellers, is black. I mean, people don't think of black as being something good, but when you put black with any color flower, it just really makes the color of the flower stand out. So, like for an elegant event, a black background, and especially this tree fern, maybe with a little sparkle on it, you know, red roses, yellow roses, pink roses, white roses, kind of like white, anything goes with black, almost any color goes with too.
Oh my, now you've piqued my curiosity. Well, speaking of different kinds of foliages, let's talk a little bit here about what kinds you guys offer. Show me the very first one that we had in the 1800s. Yeah, when it came to Florida.
This fern right here is the asparagus plumosa variety, or plumosa. It started back in the early times. They would actually plant these, and they had strings that would run up to a grid pattern. They would train the pieces of plumosa to grow up the string, and when it got fully to the top, they would cut the top and the bottom. They'd roll it up and then pack it nice, like you said, on train cars all to the northeast floral markets.
So, it still is a beautiful foliage.
Very beautiful
today.
Very popular.
What else do we have?
Of course, you talked about our leadleaf fern. This is probably our number one seller. It's the most popular variety. It's kind of what built our industry.
Is it still popular?
It's very popular still. It's our standby. I mean, this is what pays the bills every day.
What are the trends? Is it staying with this, or is it moving to different types of foliage?
What's happening is other foliages become more mainstream. People want new and different stuff. So as new foliages come on and become more popular, maybe a little bit less leadleaf is sold. So at one time, you know, that was 70 or 80% of our sales. Now it's probably around 30 to 40% of our sales as all these other varieties become more and more popular and they become available.
Wow.
This is a tree fern. It's another type of asparagus, kind of a unique thing. This and the plumosa, since they are types of asparagus, they're very closely related to the asparagus like you might find on your dinner plate.
But you don't eat it. It's
no,
not edible.
No, I mean, it is edible when it comes in a spear. Well, before this opens up and feathers out like that, it looks just like a piece of asparagus, only much thinner.
I see.
So,
good for those on a diet, right?
Very much so.
All right.
And this is another type of asparagus. It's the foxtail fern. And there's four or five different varieties of asparagus. Another one's Ming fern, which we don't have here, but it's very popular.
And this
also
is supposed to resemble a foxtail.
Yeah, it looks kind of like a foxtail. That's why they call it, that is a Myrai or foxtail. So.
Now, is this invasive? Is any of these invasive?
No, I mean, they're have to be cultivated. If you try to grow this in the wild, it wouldn't do very well. The plumosa actually is a little bit invasive. That'll kind of creep into other, if people plant that as a landscaping plant, it'll creep into a lot of their other plants and become hard to control sometimes.
So. I see. So only experienced people should. All right. Now introduce.
We have Nagai here, which is another very popular one. A very popular green in weddings and things like that is one, I don't know if you can see it down here, but it's the Italian ruscus, they call it. It's a lot, it's kind of like this, but delicate. But this is the variety that we grow in Florida.
It's beautiful, it's glossy.
Yeah, it's very nice. It's got a nice glossy leaf and a good pattern for cut foliage.
Right.
We've got Liriope here. This is the variegated variety. We also have it in a green variety. It's nice because people want something with some height sometimes that can drape. So
I love the variegation. Nice, it's so pretty. Does it only come in this?
No, we sell a lot of it in green, too. Okay. The green's also very popular, both colors.
You know what? And if somebody were allergic to flower arrangements, these foliage aren't.
So no, they're very hypoallergenic. I mean,
yeah.
The only one that has a little bit of an allergy problem that I hear about from time to time is the eucalyptus. Occasionally, some people are sensitive to eucalyptus, but most all the other ones are pretty hypoallergenic.
You know, we have Amara on the phone, and she'd like to ask you a question. Hi, Amara, welcome to the program. What's your question for David?
Oh, hi. David, my question is, I need to know how to grow staghorn ferns.
Staghorn ferns.
Staghorn fern. That's, yes. It doesn't make a very good cut foliage. A lot of people grow that, you know, as a potted plant. We actually do not grow any staghorn foliage, so I'm not a very good expert to answer any questions about staghorns.
But I would suggest you contact your local extension office, and we'll give you some free publications and teach you how to grow that staghorn fern, because they are so spectacular.
They're beautiful.
And once you can grow those, you do have a green thumb.
Very much so.
All right, now let's look at this. Is this a papyrus?
This is actually a type of papyrus. We call it umbrella palm for the obvious reasons. It kind of looks like an umbrella without the cloth on it. You know, and it is a type of papyrus, which, you know, everybody knows that was where the first paper came from. So
yes.
It's a very popular item also.
It kind of reminds me of Mary Poppins when, never mind, chimney sweeps.
This one is our Pittosporum, which is also a very popular green, and a lot of you might recognize it as a landscape plant in Florida. It comes in a variegated variety also, but it's very popular here in Florida as a landscape plant also, but it also looks very attractive in foliage arrangements.
We've got Romeo on the line. Hi, Romeo. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
My question is, is this a good startup type of business? Does it take a lot of acres land to start this up, or is it something you can start out small and work your way up?
Some people have started out small and worked their way up. Matter of fact, most farms, that's the way they started, was small. Nowadays, because it's such a competitive industry, it's very difficult, and it's a very low profit, low margin item, and it requires tremendous expense to start up. It's probably anywhere between $20,000 to $30,000 an acre to start a fernery and get it into production. So it's not something you can just walk into easily.
Yeah, plus try to secure your markets as well.
Correct.
Viewers, again, I want to give you the number to the program. Again, it's 1-800-901-9238. How long have you been in business now, David?
Fern Trust has been in business since 1986. My family actually started growing fern in 1960, and our original family farm was started five generations ago. So
wow.
We've been in business in our area for a long time. The crops we grow have kind of evolved over the years, but foliage has been my contribution to my grandfather actually planted the first plants in 1960, and it's grown from a small planting, kind of like the guy talked about, to, you know, a large production area.
Are you cutting those same fern today, or do you have to replant?
Most ferns don't have to be replanted. We're actually cutting from the same original stock plants that my grandfather bought back in the 60s.
Wow.
Those plants have been moved around to different ferneries and spread. You know, they're spread by digging them up and pulling the plants apart. You look for a growing eye in the plant and replant those. But most of the ferneries now have been in production probably in the order between 10 and 30 years.
When you grow the rhizome, do you cover it with dirt, or do you pretty much place it on top of the soil?
No, it's covered with dirt,
okay.
Yeah.
Quite a bit, or just a little bit?
An inch or two under. Okay. You want it to be able to stand up a little, because you have just the rhizome, and you usually leave a few of the fronds upright to be able to feed the root a little bit. They usually die off, but it's important to get that plant growing, that it kind of stay upright as long as possible.
Now, I know you also have to frost protect the ferns. Are there some that are a little bit more tolerant to the cold weather?
Yeah, a lot of the, you know, more woody type ornamentals, the ones that have the woody stems, are a little more cold tolerant. The Ledley ferns are very frost sensitive. They can take cold weather if they don't get frost in them. They can take down to like 26 to 28 degrees. But the problem is, we get frost usually in Florida when it gets that cold. And if it gets any frost on it whatsoever, it'll turn red and get a burn on it. And it's not sellable at that point.
Can you paint that and then sell it?
Not the leather leaf so much, but some of the other varieties still will paint afterwards. But the leather leaf, when it turns red like that, it kind of causes the plant to senesce a little too much to be able to paint.
I see. We got Peggy on the line. Hi, Peggy. Welcome to the program. What's your question for David?
I have several plants of the foxtail fern, and I'd like to know, they get a light green instead of the dark green. I'd like to know, what kind of fertilizer am I supposed to use on them?
A balanced fertilizer usually works the best, but, I mean, foxtail does have a little bit of a lighter green color naturally than most of the other ferns do. A good fern with a good supply of nitrogen, though, you know, a balanced, you know, 808 or 828 is very popular. Also, a lot of people use, like, the Peters 20-20-20 liquid fertilizer in a liquid spray. That, especially in a small area, that will usually green up plants pretty well.
David, I want to talk about this variety. Tell me a little bit about it.
This is what we call feather fern. It's very similar to the Boston and the hanging ferns that you see, but it's also very popular because of the way it stands upright in a flower arrangement.
Just kind of provides the height.
Yeah, the height and a little bit of different color. And also because it keeps the tender tips on it, it gives a look of freshness, you know?
Yes.
It looks like it's still trying to grow in
the
flower
arrangement.
Yeah, because
it's a two-tone. I mean, you can see the yellowing of it.
Yeah.
What a great combination.
And if you keep it moist and in water, it holds up really well, even with the tender tips on it. Whereas a lot of varieties, if you harvest them when they still are tender like that, they just shrivel back and die.
So you need to add water to them rather quickly.
Yes.
All right, tell me a little bit about this beautifully textured.
This is a Milky Way Aspidistra. It's similar to what a lot of people call cast iron plant. The speckle on it, of course, is where it gets its name, Milky Way. It's also a very hardy plant. This one's very, very tough. I mean, you could leave it laying right here on this table for a month and it would still look about like it does.
Wow.
I mean, that's where the cast iron plant got its name, because it's so hardy.
Yes. Now, taking a look at this variety here, this is a fall type of flower arrangement, and you have some beautiful variegation on some of the foliage here naturally, or did you paint this?
No, this is natural variegated Aspidistra. It's actually, you know, very similar to the Milky Way.
But
this is a variegated Aspidistra or cast iron plant. It's very, very good. It's hard to grow without getting blemishes on it, but it's a very good seller. Actually, we usually have far more demand than we have supply on this type of foliage.
Wow. Now tell me a little bit now, David, about how you guys are doing without the flowers being delivered to funerals, homes, or weddings. What is the trend now? Having flowers is always quite comforting to see them.
Yeah, well, of course, you know, we respect everybody's rights to grieve how they want to, but there's been a lot of university studies done that show that in the grieving process, flowers are a very important part of it. And there's nothing really more depressing than to go to somebody's funeral and there be no flowers, you know, there at it. So, and in lieu of flowers is something we don't like to see. We would like to see people make donations to worthy causes, but also, you know, maybe still send somebody a nice flower arrangement, because it really does help heal hearts.
And
that's,
you know, David, when we go to the grocery stores, how do we know they're from Florida? Is there a Fresh from Florida sticker, or who should we ask?
We're developing a Fresh from Florida program to put those things on our boxes. But it is also very important to make sure you ask your local florist where they get their ferns from. I mean, even in this local area, there are a lot of ferns that come in from other places, or maybe there's no fern in the arrangements. You know, like Karen said, 80% of the foliage is consumed in the U.S. are grown right here in the and Florida area, but 80% of the flowers and other things are grown out of the country. So we'd like to make sure that we keep our part of Florida a part of the floral industry in the rest of the world. So if you can and you go shopping, make sure you ask them, is this fern in this from Florida, or can you include some fern from Florida?
Because it hires so many people in the state of Florida.
Correct.
We've got another caller on the line, Victoria. Hi, Victoria. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
I was wondering if you can grow a foxtail fern as a potted plant in your home.
Yes, it grows very well as a potted plant. It's a good item. So,
is it easy to grow?
I would say it's fairly easy to grow. It's not easy to grow if you plant, you know, an acre of it and try to cultivate it, because in your home you want it to look perfect, but you got to remember, when we're growing stuff, it has to be totally blemish free to be in a flower arrangement. So sometimes a little bug bite or this, that, or the other on it in your home might not be as devastating to you as it is to us when we're growing it as a decorative floral item.
We've got Jenny on the line. Hi, Jenny. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
I would like to know how to separate a foxtail fern that's really pot-bound.
Got any tricks? Do you use a knife? Do you use scissors?
How to separate? The best way is to just pick it up by hand and break it apart, and you'll see under the ground, there's a lot of little knots and things like that, but you want to break those apart gently and make sure you get a good part of the root knot that has the little hair roots coming off of it as you separate it and put it into different pots. So
that's a good way, a good tip. Mm-hmm. Now, David, I know, I want to get back to the coloring portion of it. I know each year they try to introduce different colors. Tell me a little bit about what was this year's, what was last year's, what do you see for the future for colors? Now, you mentioned, tell me the names of these colors.
Well, we started out a few years back. Chocolate weddings were very popular, so and when you look at flowers, there's not really a chocolate-colored rose or this, that, or the other, so we came up with a chocolate-colored tree fern, so we started trying to look at color trends and what was going to be popular. I think a year before last, it was a tangerine color that was very popular. This year, emerald is a popular color. And it all goes with weddings and, you know, what trends you happen to see. And they change, as you know.
And you stay up on those. You have to stay up.
We try to stay very closely in tune to it because even though we mix our own paint in-house and can do any type of color, we try to market our stuff, so when we know that a color is going to be popular, we try to get out to our customers and say, hey, we got this foliage and the color that's going to be really popular over the next several months. So.
Right, set the trend. Okay, well, tell me, what's the name of this one?
That's a copper-colored
tree
fern. Yeah, it's a very popular color, and it's kind of difficult to come up with that color paint. The other one is burgundy, which is the color next to it. That's just, you can imagine where the name came from that. It kind of looks like a burgundy wine color. So.
It does. Now, I notice you also over here in this arrangement have gold. And do you make silver as well?
We do gold and silver. That arrangement there has a lot of the Florida Christmas type foliages that we grow. You know, in Florida, a lot of the country, you know, produces evergreens, but the one thing we have in Florida that looks very Christmassy and like evergreen are the different types of cypress. We grow a Leland cypress, like you see in the back of this arrangement here, and then a regular redwood cedar, and this one is like Carolina sapphire, they call it. They're popular for Christmas because they can't get that from other parts of the country, and it adds a different texture and a little different odor. And we can take and put gold and silver and copper and whatever other color, you know, like reds and whites. We do a white Color Fresh that has a little sparkle on it. It kind of looks like snow on it. That's very, very popular.
Wow, who says we can't have a winter in Florida?
Very much so.
Now, what is the hardest color to put on your foliage? They have trouble sticking? Or?
You know, a true red is a very hard color to put on it because it's kind of like when you paint something else. Not only are you painting it's not like you're painting a white piece of paper. You're painting something that's green already. So when you put a color over it, you kind of got to block the colors behind it. And when you try to put red over things, when the color of the green mixes with it, it makes it very difficult to come up with that color.
Okay, now you have red on this center arrangement that we have down here in front, and that's a spectacular.
Yeah, that's got, I think, our more burgundy-colored oak leaves we do. We do the oak leaves in three colors. We have this, like you can see here, it's kind of what we call our maple color. It's got two different tones of, like, yellows and browns and reds in it. We do a true two-tone here that we call that's got the red and the yellow colors, kind of looks like a natural fall leaf from up north, even though we are doing it with
sure
paint.
Does.
Yeah, these are Florida oak leaves that were grown in Florida. So
wow, everything here is from Florida.
Yeah.
Now, when you paint them, how long does it take for them to dry? Then you can actually put them in an arrangement. Does it take a couple days or instant?
No, we have a special, like I said, process. It's a patented way that we can paint these things and within probably 30 minutes or so have them dry enough that we can include them into either a floral arrangement or sell them in bulk.
How many fern growers are there in the state of Florida, roughly?
It changes all the time. There's less and less every year just because of the competition from other parts of the world. And like I said, the profit margins are a little small. But I think there's about 80 shippers right now in Florida, grower shippers. And
how much is shipped internationally and how much is shipped locally in the nation?
It, you know, it used to be about 50-50, but now I would say probably 90% goes either to the U.S. or Canada into the North American market and maybe only 10% of its export, mainly because we've had such intense competition from Central and South America. They have a real advantage when it comes to labor, and their costs are much lower than ours, so they start out a little bit ahead of us in the game.
Right. What do you see for the future for cut foliage? Is it getting bigger? Is it just getting more diverse?
I think the future's brighter. I wouldn't keep doing it every day. I mean, I love going to work every morning. I get up. I think about cut foliage, unfortunately, when I get up in the morning and before I go to bed at night. I think there's a bright future in it. I think the varieties, as they continue to change and evolve over time, and we work with designers, you know, all over the world to incorporate greens into their flower arrangements, I think the future's rosy, even though it's for greens.
It's great. You know, a woman really doesn't need flowers when they have this beautiful diversity of plants, and your wife must be lucky to have all these different colors to choose from.
Yeah, she likes having fresh arrangements in her house.
Painted colors. Mm-hmm. My goodness, that's adorable. Well, from all of this cut foliage, do you have a favorite? Which one you like or the easiest to grow?
I don't know about the easiest to grow, but I do actually, I love the level leaf and the plumosa, two of the old favorites. The plumosa, you know, it's just got such a nice, deep, dark green color to
it.
And the level leaf, they're two classics that I think will never go away, and they're my favorites. They're actually very difficult to grow in a commercial way, though.
Wow. Well, we're out of time today, and I'd like to thank David Register and all of you for joining into the program. You can always email me at wdsc@daytonastate.edu if you have any further questions. Thanks for tuning in tonight, and we'll see you next week on Gardener's Hotline.